علمتنا إنك سميع مجيب الدعاء. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع وقلب لا يخشى ونفس لا تشبع ودعاء لا يسمع. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي يا ربي آمين. I actually thought of this topic, subhanAllah, Allah brought it to my mind when I was in Mecca. Don't ask me why. Suddenly, I don't even recall I was reading the Qur'an, or maybe I was reviewing, and suddenly the question came to my mind, subhanAllah, how many times the same story is repeated in the Qur'an? And it's like something came to my mind, I was like, this is something I'm sure a lot of people ask the same question. And why do we have stories to start with? And why do they are repeated? And why some stories are much longer than the other? And why the same story, one part of the Qur'an is one word or one line, and another part of the Qur'an, it's the whole page, or sometimes the whole surah is about it. So Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, there's books written about this. I found only one book in English. It's actually the best scholar who wrote about this. It's Imam Ibn Kathir. And a lot of people don't know that. They know his tafsir, but actually he has a huge book, volumes, about the stories of the Qur'an. Then it was summarized, and it translated the summarized one. So for you, if you want to go into the detail, it's a good thing for the children. It's the best bedtime story. Instead of reading Bambi and reading all these things, honestly, especially if you read it in a nice way. I mean, you read it as a story. It's not like a preaching. And then the children will learn a lot. But I want to start with a story also, but not from the Qur'an actually. It's about the Qur'an, and this story some of you may know. So the story starts like this. It's the scenario is actually in Mecca. This is, of course, after the Rasul became the Prophet, and he was sitting alone in around the Kaaba. And the non-believers were sitting watching him. And then they were talking, and one of them said, go and talk to him, and maybe he will change his mind. And one of them was his uncle, Abu Jahl. And he said, with the group sitting there, like imagine you're sitting there and said, you know what, this is a good time, let's go and talk to him. So they send Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, who is one of the leaders of Quraysh, and he is extremely rich, is not rich, extremely rich. They say what he had at that time can fill the space between Mecca and Ta'if. Mecca and Ta'if is 1 hour drive, a little bit more actually. Rasulullah s.a.w. walked, if you remember, when he went to Ta'if. So his wealth was that much. And he had 9 children, 9 sons. One of them, the most famous one, is Khalid ibn al-Walid. Yeah, this is his father. So he came to Rasulullah s.a.w. And I'm just making the story short, because I want you to feel how much stories make an ayah or a surah or a part of the Quran much easier and to reflect and to learn. So he came to him and he said, and I'm just rephrasing, what it will take to make you stop doing this? You want money? We'll give you what you want. You want to be the leader? We will make you the leader. You want something? You name it and we will do it. And Rasul ﷺ did not answer. And then he kept talking. And he said, are you done? And this is one of the things you learn. When somebody is talking to you, listen. He said, are you done? He said, yes, I am done. So Rasul ﷺ recited Quran to him. He didn't answer. He just recited Quran to him. And I don't recall exactly which one he read. It was not a najm. Now it's not coming to me. Inshallah, it will come. Anyway, so Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, now remember that time, like now these days you say Shakespearean English, right? They all lived in Shakespearean Arabic, and I'm just rephrasing. The level of the Arabic, if you read the poetry, not the Quran, if you read the poetry, you need a book to explain. So he was reciting Quran to him, and you could see, what the story says, that the face of Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira changed. And his heart became softer. And then he said, okay, and went back to his people. He was like his Kaaba, Rasulullah was sitting here, and they were there. When he came back, they looked at each other and said, he changed. His heart became softer, right? And then they said, what did he tell you? right? And then he described the Quran, and this is where I wanted you, because when I tell you this story, when you read the Quran, it will be different because the story, what it does. And he put it in a beautiful Arabic, and I'm going to do my best to translate. He said, his words is neither poetry that we know, nor is the written things we normally write. And then he started describing. He said, the way he speaks, meaning the words, not the way, the words he speaks has so much beauty. لقوله عليه لحلاوة, so sweet. وإن عليه لطلاوة. Of course, he has to speak in a very eloquent Arabic, so you can all know it rhymes. طلاوة is actually the upper layer of something. We use طلاء when you paint. The outer side is called طلاء. طلاوة means on top of what he's saying, it has more sweetness and grace. It's very attractive what he is saying. And it brings a fruit, although I don't see a fruit. And it's like a flood when it comes out of his mouth, as if there is a flooding coming out. This is how I felt. And then they said, what does that mean? Because now they are very worried that he is going to be a Muslim. And if he became a Muslim, he's one of their leaders. So Abu Jahl immediately, he said, you say this to your family. You say this to your people and see what will happen to you. So he retracted and he said, okay. Let me think. If they ask me what I am going to say. So he changed his mind. He didn't become Muslim. He died. And this is one of the miracles of the Quran, because I'm going to recite to you the ayat about this story. And then he said, you know what? I think this is a magic. He's a magician, but he's a good one. And Allah revealed it, which surah? ذَرْنِي وَمَنْ خَلَقْتُ وَحِيدًا وَأَمْدَدْتُ لَهُ مَالًا مَمْدُودًا وَبَنِينَ شُهُودًا. Leave me, Allah is saying this to Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. He didn't believe. So immediately Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, leave him. And Allah is saying, leave him to me. وَمَنْ خَلَقْتُ وَحِيدًا. I created him alone. And I gave him an endless amount of wealth. And men, boys, children, boys at that time. He had 9. One of them is Khalid ibn Walid. وَبَنِينَ شُهُودَ ثُمَّ يَطْمَعُ وَأَنَ أَزِيدَ. Then he wants more. كَلَّا. Nay. سَأُرْهِقُهُ صَعُودًا. I am gonna punish him in a way, it's one of the punishments, like as you go up and up and up and you get tired and you're gonna keep going up and up and up. سَأُرْهِقُهُ صَعُودًا. Now comes, this is exactly describing the story. إِنَّهُ فَكَّرَ وَقَدَّرَ. He thought about it. فَقُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرَ. Meaning woe on him. How did he think? Meaning, why didn't he think the right way? فَقُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرَ. And Allah repeated it again. ثُمَّ قُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرَ. ثُمَّ أَدْبَرَ. Then he turned away and says, إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا سُحْرٌ يُؤْثَى. This is not the words of the human being. This is words of a human being. This is actually a magician. And this is one of the proofs that the Quran is the words of Allah, because scholars argue Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira died and he was not a believer. If this was said by someone else, it could have easily changed. But when this was revealed, he could have changed later on. This was not revealed after he died. Did you get my point? So I say, let's assume I write and I say, you're going to be living all your life in St. Louis. Right? Can you change your mind in a year and you move? Or something happens? But he didn't. He did not become a Muslim till he died, although this was revealed way earlier, sort of Tawr, or Kitabin Mastur. So stories in general in the Quran, and this is why, see, I captured your attention once I see a story. That's exactly what Allah wants us to do. Having stories in the Quran, it's one of the ways to bring our attention. And there's 3 kinds of stories in the Quran. three kinds. There's the stories of the prophets. That's why when you read books, you can read stories of the Quran or stories of the prophets. So one inside the other. So stories of the prophets. What is the most common, the commonest or the longest, the most frequent prophet's story in the Quran? Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam. It's very interesting, right? Not the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. Not Sayyidina Isa, right? Sayyidina Musa, and then Sayyidina Ibrahim, Sayyidina Nuh, and the others. So the first group of stories is the prophets, which we all know. What is the other stories in the Quran that's not related to the prophets? Not related to prophets. I'm going to give you just general today. And then inshallah, as if Allah give us life, we'll go more into the, some of the stories. For example, the Qarnayn, think of Surah Al-Kahf, that's the easiest one. Because you have there at least three stories not related to prophets. Although some says it's four, because Al-Khidr with Sayyidina Musa is also not a... Al-Khidr in the most probably correct way, he's not a prophet also. So the Qarnayn, people of the cave, Luqman, Sayyidina Luqman, and he was also not a prophet. People of the garden, mashallah, right? Also in Surah Al-Kahf, So many, there's like 20 plus. You all read the Quran, right? These are the prophets. That's the prophets. Remember I told you, when you look at the stories, there's a prophet, so you name them. Sayyidina Musa, Sayyidina Ibrahim, Isa, Ad, Samud, Lut, Nuh, all these. Abu Lahab is not a story. Abu Lahab is his name in the Quran came not as a story, came as a warning to him. But stories. Saba. You always remember this, right? Saba. What about the Hudhud? The bird with Sayyidina Sulaiman. Sayyidina Sulaiman and the other animal? The ants. Right? These are all stories. Now, most of the stories is true stories, meaning it happened, or sometimes it's stories without details, without names. For example, one you all know, because you know Surah Yasin very well. Right? Right? وَجَاءَ مِنْ أَقْصَى الْمَدِينَةِ رَجُلٌ يَسْعَى. From the end of the village, a man came in, walking quickly. يَا قَوْمِ اتَّبِعُوا الْمُرْسَلِينَ. Believe them. Surah Yasin, it's a story. But one of the interesting about the stories of the Quran, especially when it is related to the prophets, there is no name. Surah Yasin, there is no name. It's a man, right? In Surah Al-Qasas, the same story. But the other way around. جَاءَ رَجُلٌ مِّنْ أَقْصَى الْمَدِينَةِ. A man came from the end, from far away and said, Musa, leave. They're going to kill you. Who is this man? Third, Surah Ghafir, maybe some of you know this, right? It's called Mu'minu Ali Fir'aun, the man who believed from the people of Fir'aun. No name. Two pages about him in the Quran. No name. SubhanAllah, go to Surah Ghafir. So that's a second part of the stories of the Quran. There is more. Surah Al-Baqarah has a lot, right? The man who had the donkey, no name. Right? The man who argued with Sayyidina Ibrahim about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? Talut and Jalut, also in Al-Baqarah. What about the sons of Adam? So you go and you go through the Quran actually. I tried to figure out exactly how much of the Quran is real stories. It comes to almost about half of it. If you combine all. The third kind of the stories is stories about the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. Especially the expeditions. So if you read Surah Ali Imran, the name of Uhud is not mentioned. But about 5 to 10 pages of Ali Imran is about that battle. And not the battle itself. That's very important, the story. It's not the battle, it's what happened. And what happened meaning how they disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and what happened to them. In Surah Al-Anfal is Badr. Sometimes the expedition mentioned by name, Hunayn. Tabuk. So the stories are three kinds. When we don't limit it to the stories of the prophets only. Actually, the other stories are even more interesting. One surah of the Quran, all of it about a story. Yusuf alayhi salam. And one surah in the Quran, two-thirds of it about a story. Al-Qasas is about Sayyidina Musa. It's the only time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about Sayyidina Musa when he was a baby. When he told his mother, what? Breastfeed him, throw him in the river, don't worry, we'll bring him back to you. This is baby, breastfeeding. Till he became a man, prophet, and then he made the mistake and killed the man. And then he left, then he got married, then he became a prophet, then went to Fir'aun. All the story is an al-qasas. So sometimes you see Sayyidina Musa, one name, sometimes a whole pages. Things for us as Muslim to know about the stories of the Quran, and this is very important for all of us, especially when you talk to children. Number one, and this is all what Allah said about stories in the Quran. Number one, the best story is the stories of the Quran. It's not because we are Muslims and we are bragging about it, but because the creator of you and me and the words, what he said in his book, that's what he said. What did he say? In Surah Yusuf, نحن نقص عليك أحسن القصص. We are going to recite, we're going to tell you, we don't know the story yet. Imagine you're reading the Quran for the first time, and you're reading Surah Yusuf, second ayah, third ayah, we are talking, we're going to tell you the best story. And some scholars teaches you and me that when you say, hey, I'm going to tell you the best story ever you heard. You know, we all say this. They say this is lack of etiquette with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the best story is the stories of the Quran, and especially the story of Sayyidina Yusuf. Number one, best stories ever. Number two, the most truthful stories. There is no doubt about them, and the details of the stories is all true. Is all true. Number three, why there is stories in the Quran. MashaAllah, tabarakallah. MashaAllah, tabarakallah. Why there are stories in the Quran? Let's get one by one. So we all have to think. When think of you and me, and I started with a story to bring this subject. The best way to explain it is by either parable, example, or a story. For example, you want to tell your child, son or daughter, right? Or a younger brother, you are the older, you graduate from college, and he or she is going to college. You want to tell them, don't make mistakes, right? What do you say? If you can tell them, don't make mistakes, then nobody will listen, right? So what do you normally do? You bring a story, right? You're going to say, you know what? Let me tell you the story of my first day in college. Let me tell you after a year, when I decided to share the room with someone, if you want to try to tell him not share, or you want to tell him share. My point, stories always bring the point easier. And why there is stories in the Quran, not only to bring it easier, but to explain it to us and to make us more firm. More firm. And Allah said this to Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. If you go to Surah Hud, Surah Hud is all about the stories of the prophets from the beginning till the end, except almost the last page. At the end of Surah Hud, Allah says this to Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. Like you say, why all these stories? He says, وَكُلَّا نَقَصُ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ أَنْبَاءِ الرُّسُلِ مَا نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ. And I'll translate. وَكُلًّا, everyone, نَقَصُ, reciting the story. عليك, to you, Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, من أنباء الرسل, from the previous prophets, stories. You and me say, it's like, why he's telling us, right? I'm like, what I'm going to learn from the story of Ad? It comes to us, honestly, it comes to us, like, okay, and then he's telling him, مثبت به فؤادك, to stay firm. I'll give you one example, right? And this is for us women. The story, which woman in the Quran, that her story so close to every wife. Her story is not mentioned in the Quran. Yes, who said that? Pharaoh's wife. Imra'ata Fir'aun. Her name is not mentioned. And it's only one ayah. End of Surah Al-Tahrim. One ayah. ضرب الله مثلا. This is actually a parable and it's a true story. Together. In one ayah. Allah give the parable to the believers. You and me. The wife of Fir'aun. No name. SubhanAllah. You know her name, Asiya, from the seerah. From the what Rasul taught us. But in the Quran there is no name. What does that tell me? It doesn't matter what my name is. And who I am. Is what I am doing. Because even the wife of Sayyidina Nuh. And the wife of Sayyidina Lut. And she, the wife of Fir'aun, no name. The only one her name mentioned afterward is Maryam. The end of Surah Al-Tahrim for women. I had this beautiful discussion last week with one of the ladies. I was like, women in the Quran, we really just don't know it very well. One page of the Quran, four women are mentioned. One after the other. So the wife of Fir'aun, and Allah said it in two lines, what makes every Muslim woman, that she thinks her husband is not religious enough, is not making her practice. You know how we blame others? And sometimes it's an obstacle. And sometimes maybe it is not really the whole obstacle. The story of this woman in these three lines teach me the following. And Allah, and I'll recite to the ayah. ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مْرَأَةَ فِرْعَوْنَ. Allah gave the example of the wife of Fir'aun. The word Fir'aun, Pharaoh, what does it make you feel? What is Pharaoh? Tyrant, right? Unjust, mightiness, killing, ruthlessness, you name it, all comes to you, right? Arrogance, absolutely. So Allah said this is the story of his wife, right? He said two lines, and the whole story is clear. It's qalat, she said, رَبِّ ابْنِ لِي عِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. Ya Allah, build for me house next to you in paradise. And even scholars, and it's a very nice linguistic beauty that she chose the neighbor before the neighborhood. Did you get the point? She chose the neighbor before the neighborhood because she said, Ya Allah, build a house for me with you in Jannah. Not in Jannah, with you. So number one, she made a dua. But then what's the story? What I'm going to learn? Okay, I'm going to go and make this dua. The next line is what it is for you and me as a story to learn. وَنَجِّنِي مِن فِرْعَوْنَ وَعَمَلِهِ. Save me from Fir'aun and not Fir'aun and what he's doing. And not Fir'aun only. وَنَجِّنِي مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ. Get me out of this people. Three lines. Story, or when you read this, like, okay, who's the wife of Fir'aun? Obviously, she was married to Fir'aun, and Fir'aun, throughout the Quran, you will learn, tyrant. What did she do? She was patient. She didn't change. She stayed steadfast. And Allah gave her house in Jannah. Every woman, this is a simple story, applies to every woman, that she thinks the surroundings, and I'm not talking necessarily a married woman, the surroundings is way obstacle for her. And she says, I cannot get better. I cannot do this. I cannot get closer to Allah because of my family, my job, my work, my husband, whatever. They all are pulling me away. And I always say to her, just go and read this ayah. And then once you read the ayah, and you're going to have more interest in who is Fir'aun and what did he do to her, then you're going to say, wow. Wow. So the stories of the Quran, especially for us, sometimes one line or two lines. The most beloved stories for me in the Quran is actually Sayyidina Sulaiman with the ant. With the ant. And this is a story that also applies to all of us. How many bounties we have? How many bounties we have? If we start counting, we're not ever going to be able to. Even in our limited ability, still we will forget things, right? So Sayyidina Sulaiman, which you all know, with his all entourage, وَحُشِرَ لِسُلَيْمَانَ جُنُودَ, all the soldiers were with Sulaiman walking, and he see this ant. No one is seeing her. No one is hearing her, right? قَالَتْ يَا أَيَّهَا النَّمْلُ. She's the leader. Immediately, wallah, when you read the commentary on this, it's a whole, they say, army, how to plan to save your nation. Read what did the Namla said. Number one, don't panic. She didn't panic. There's a leader, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّمْلُ. Oh, ants, وَدْخُلُوا مَسَاكِنَكُمْ. She gave them the order right away. Get inside. And then you have to explain why. لَا يَحْطِمَنَّكُمْ سُلَيْمَانُ وَجُنُودُ. Sulaiman will crush you. And the word itself is an ajaz. It's a scientific miracle in the Quran, right? So Sulaiman heard it. Now this, look at this story. Beautiful story. You read it to your children, I was like, oh, every time you see an ant, don't panic. Remember Sayyidina Sulaiman. So what did Sayyidina Sulaiman? He heard her. He was the only one, because that's what Allah gave him. He understood. Allah gave him the ability to understand what animals say. So he understood. And he smiled. تَبَسَّمَ ضَاحِكًا مِنْ قَوْلِهَا. He smiled and his two like teeth, side teeth, were able to be seen. So what did he say? Smart ant. Oh yeah. We need to learn from her. Or what does... Immediately said, رَبِّ أَوْزَعْنِي أَنْ أَشْكُرَ نِعْمَتَكَ الَّتِي أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِ. Ya Allah, immediately, make me grateful to the ni'mah, to the bounties that you gave me. Which bounty? He didn't mention. Obviously, in this case, is the bounty that Allah chose him alone from all his creation to understand what the ants say. So each one of us in this room, each one of us listening, have a bounty that Allah chose you. We have common bounties, but there's a bounty. And sometimes you only know it and Allah knows it. It's immediately, what did he say? Immediately turn to Allah. أَوْزِعْنِي, Ya Allah, please help me. Meaning, I can't do it alone because we are usually not grateful. قَلِيلٌ مِّنْ عِبَادِيَ الشَّكُورِ. Very few of my servants are grateful. Make me grateful to you, Ya Allah. That the bounty you gave me, not only me, وَعَلَى وَالِدَيْنِ, and my parents. أَوْزِعْنِ أَشْكُرْ نِعْمَتَكَ الَّتِي أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيَّ وَعَلَى وَالِدَيْنِ وَأَنْ أَعْمَلَ صَالِحًا تَرُضَاهُ. Help me. Please forgive me. Help me to do good deed that pleases you. And look at the last one. This last one is the goal of the story. وَأَدْخِلْنِي بِرَحْمَتِكَ فِي عِبَادِكَ الصَّالِحِينَ. Sayyidina Sulaiman, the prophet. And you help me to enter by your mercy with your righteous people. With the righteous people. So what is he? What is Sayyidina Sulaiman? He's a prophet. He's a prophet. But look at the humbleness. So this is story, simple. It's an end. And there's so many things. But for us, every time you read a story in the Quran, what you need to do is, what does it do to me? What is going to teach me? So when I read Sayyidina Sulaiman, or when I read the wife of Fir'aun, and there's many, many, many more, especially, I'm not talking about the Qusus al-Anbiya. We'll come to it later, inshallah, later on another halaqa. But I'm talking about the non-prophet's stories. Ashab al-Jannah, Surah Nun, the 29th part of the Quran. So the people who have the garden, right, the group, what did they say? What did they say? In Surah Nun, right? They say, we're going to go. We have a beautiful garden. We're not going to give it to anybody. And we're going to take all the fruits. And we're not giving it to anybody. We worked very hard for it. Immediately Allah vanished it. It's gone. Gone. Overnight. They came in the morning. There was nothing in it. Then they start saying, oh, we are not grateful. What does this teach me? Again, the qisas, the stories of the Quran. The idea is not to read a story. The idea is, what is this story telling me? Me, you, us, 2019, living in this day and age. that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all what we have, homes, children, wealth, beauty, education, status, can take it in a minute. In a minute. I mean, subhanAllah, how many times Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially this year, la ilaha illallah, showed us with the weather, how things can change in a minute. I always remember this ayah, يُقَلِّبُ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارِ. He turns day and night. But one, I mean, we've seen it yesterday morning. If you were up in the morning, la ilaha illallah. What is this rain? So every story in the Quran is actually truth, the best ever, and the goal is always lofty. Sometimes you see people carrying a book and you say, why are you reading? It's a nice story. Very common. And you say, so what is it all about? I don't know, it's a silly thing, but it's just, it's a good, right? And sometimes, no, it's a beautiful story. It has really good goal. I learned a lot. And sometimes the story is all suspense. And I was like, I don't know what is going to happen. Who's going to die? Who's going to live? Right? Who's going to marry who? So different stories of the Quran, one of their characters, they always have lofty goals. Every time you read a story, there's two things you will say to yourself. I want to be like this, or I don't want to be like this. I want to be like Sayyidina Sulaiman. I want to be like the wife of Pharaoh. I want to be like Sayyidina Ibrahim. I don't want to be like Fir'aun. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put me when I was about to drown. Then now I believed. So every time you read a story, it's lofty, the goal, and it's truthful, and it's the best ever. One of the stories also in the Quran that is not related to the prophets. Can you think of anyone else that you know?
Not related to prophets.
Yeah, it's not about the prophets. Not the stories of the prophet. Today we're going to cover the non-prophet one. What about the bird? And also with Sayyidina Sulaiman, right? Same thing in Surah, this is in Surah An-Naml, right? What is the bird? Every time you see a bird, al-hudhud. Every time you see a bird, look at this. Remember this, right? Sayyidina Sulaiman had entourage of people, animals of every kind. And then he missed the bird. He said, where is the bird? He said to everybody, where is the bird? He disappeared. I am going to torture him. I am going to kill him. Or he better come up with a good reason why he is not here. That's exactly what he said. وَتَفَقَّدَ الطَّيْرِ قَالَ مَا لِيَ لَا أَرَى الْهُدْهُدَ أَمْ كَانَ مِنَ الْغَائِبِينَ لَأُذَبِّحَنَّهُ عَذَابًا شَدِيدًا أَوْ لَأُذَبِّحَنَّهُ أَوْ لَيَأْتِيَنِّي بِنَبَئٍ يَقِينٍ. Either I'm going to torture him or kill him, or he better come with a good reason. Why you're away? فَمَكَّةَ غَيْرَ بَعِيدٍ. I want you to imagine this bird. Every time I see birds, especially if it is like similar to that one, I think of this story. He stood up with a distance from Sulaiman. He didn't run away. And he says, I brought you, look at the confidence. I brought you with a story, with the news actually, right? قَالَ جِئْتُكَ مِنْ سَبَئٍ بِنَبَئٍ يَقِينٍ. I came to you with a story or with a news, true. And Sulaiman didn't say, what? Who are you? Listen. And then he said, I found a queen. She has an amazing throne, amazing place. But they don't believe in Allah. Look at this. What do I learn from this? Again, stories of the Quran. That's true. It's beautiful. Lofty goal. What do I learn from this? How many times children come to you and says, listen, mom, do you know what happened today in school? This is a bird. It's not even a baby. It's a bird. What do I learn from this? Number one, listen. Number one, listen. Number two, don't belittle. Don't belittle. He told him something Sayyidina Sulaiman didn't know. I found a woman, a queen, and they are prostrating to Allah, huge. What did he say? سَنَنْظُرُ. We'll see. Are you saying the truth or you're lying? Take it. This is a letter from me. He gave it to the bird. Allah, this is the miracle of Sayyidina Sulaiman. He speaks to the animals. Take this book. Book, Allah is the book, meaning letter. Give it to them. And Allah immediately take us to the next scene. This is a story. Next scene. And she opens. Oh people, I got a letter from Sulaiman. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. That's the only surah in the Quran with two. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Surah An-Naml. And he's saying, let's be Muslims. What do you say? She's the queen. Says, you are the queen. Do whatever you want. Says, well, when people come and we let them in our place, they will actually torture us. And they usually will spread mischief. I have an idea. Woman, I'm going to send them gifts. Meaning, lure them. And I'm sure they will change their mind. What did Sayyidina Sulaiman do? You send me money? This is exactly how Allah says. Atumidunani bimal? You're trying to buy me? You're trying to send me a gift to change my mind? Go back. This is all to the bird. This is all to the bird. Subhanallah. When you look at a bird, don't just say it's a bird. Oh, it's beautiful. It's a beautiful. But what story? This immediately comes to your mind. What a bird. What a bird changed. What a bird brought khair, brought goodness, made the whole nation became Muslim, one bird. Allahu Akbar. Because he went back and he told them, Sulaiman says, you become a Muslim or he will destroy you. She came.
We don't know.
اذهب إليهم. Go back to them and tell them, we're coming with an army and we're going to crush you. What's at the end of the story? She became a Muslim. And some of the sayings that she even married Sayyidina Sulaiman, a bird. What does that teach me? Nothing is impossible. There's a lot from the stories, but especially, for example, this one, Allah made me remember. Nothing is impossible. You rely on Allah and everything happens. And when you rely on Allah with certainty, it's going to happen. Don't belittle any mean. A bird can do what human beings cannot do. A bird. Don't compromise easily. Money should not change us. Jobs should not change me. Wealth should not change me.
So I'm going to end up with giving you 10 reasons why the stories in the Quran has been repeated. So the same story is repeated, and this applies especially to the stories of the prophets. So they are repeated sometimes, as I said, in detail, sometimes short. Number one, when you repeat the thing, that means you are making your point and you are stressing upon it. That means it's something very important that I'm going to repeat and repeat and repeat. Number one. Number two, not a single story of the Quran of Sayyidina Musa, for example, or Sayyidina Ibrahim, meaning the same story never have been repeated the same way at all. Even if it is the same scenario, and I'll give you one example. I don't have the number of the ayah, but just go and do it for you. Go to Surah Al-A'raf and Surah Al-Shu'ara. Al-A'raf and Al-Shu'ara. It's almost the same page. It's on the left side of the Quran. And it is the scene where Sayyidina Musa is with Pharaoh and telling him, believe in Allah. You know the story that you all know. Believe in Allah, and then he brought the signs and throw the stick and all this. It is exactly the same scenario. Very few words are different. Those of you who memorize the Quran, memorizing one of them, one that you mix with. But some are, especially in the Shu'ara, one or two words is extra in the sentence. And the meaning is different in one way, or the meaning is more clearer in another way, in one word. And this is one of the scientific miracles, not scientific miracle, actually linguistic miracle of the Quran. So when you repeat the story, is you are making the point again and again and again and explaining it. One of the scholars said it's exactly like when you take a picture to someone sitting and you say, I'm taking this picture. Then just a second, turn a little bit to the left. You're still sitting. And I'll take it this way. And I'm going to take it this way. And you're just making it different. But you're the same person. But it's like, oh, this looks this way, that way. So that's the second one. The third one is the story comes in. Sometimes the same part of the story, most of the time it's not the same part of the story. Sayyidina Ibrahim one time is with his father, one time is with his people, one time is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one time he's alone in Mecca. So parts of the stories. The same, as I said, the same... Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, rabbil alamin. We'll continue next time, inshallah. Alhamdulillah.